In this video, we'll study about the subclavian artery. The subclavian artery, the right and the left subclavian artery, they carry the blood to the upper limbs. When you see the territorial supply of the subclavian artery, it extends as far as the forebrain, the abdominal wall and the fingers. Now we'll see the origin of the subclavian artery. The right subclavian artery arises from the brachiocephalic trunk and the left subclavian artery arises from the aortic arch. Since the left subclavian artery arises from the aortic arch, it has two parts, a thoracic part and a cervical part. In this video, we'll see only the cervical part of the subclavian artery. So, if you see the extent of the subclavian artery, that is the cervical part, it extends from the sternoclavicular joint up to the outer border of the first rib. So, again I repeat, it extends from the sternoclavicular joint to the outer border of the first rib. The subclavian artery is divided into three parts by the scalenus anterior muscle. The first part extend from the sternoclavicular joint up to the medial border of the muscle. The second part, which lies behind the scalenus anterior muscle, and the third part extends from the lateral border of the muscle up to the outer border of the first rib. Now we'll see the relations of the first part. In front, you have the sternocleidomastoid muscle, the sternothyroid muscle, the sternohyoid muscle and the anterior jugular vein superficial to the infrahyoid muscles. Next we have the structures in front are the internal jugular vein, the thoracic duct on the left side. Next we have the vagus nerve. The cardiac branches of the vagus nerve and the sympathetic trunk, and you have the phrenic nerve on the left side. Behind the first part, you have the cervical part of the pleura, and then you have the apex of the lung, and these are covered by the suprapleural membrane. Behind the first part of the subclavian artery, you also have the sympathetic trunk, the inferior cervical ganglion of the sympathetic trunk and the right recurrent laryngeal nerve which hooks the undersurface of the right subclavian artery. Now we'll see the relations of the second part of the subclavian artery. In front, you have the scalenus anterior muscle, the sternocleidomastoid muscle. In front of the second part, you also have the subclavian vein and the phrenic nerve on the right side. The scalenus anterior muscle intervenes between the second part of the subclavian artery and the subclavian vein. Behind the second part of the subclavian artery, you have the apex of the lung, covered by the cervical pleura and the suprapleural membrane. Then you have the lower trunk of the brachial plexus and the scalenus medius muscle. The second part of the subclavian artery emerges through a gap between the scalenus anterior muscle and the scalenus medius muscle, and its summits usually reaches about 2 cm above the clavicle. The third part of the subclavian artery extends from the lateral border of the scalenus anterior muscle to the outer border of the first rib, and it rests on the groove on the upper surface of the first rib. This part appears in the posterior triangle of the neck. From the outer border of the first rib, the subclavian artery continues as axillary artery. Now we'll see the branches of the first part of the subclavian artery. So from the first part, you get the vertebral artery. Then you have the internal thoracic artery. Then you have the thyrocervical trunk. On the left side, The costo-cervical trunk arises from the first part of the subclavian artery. On the right side, the costo-cervical trunk arises from the second part of the subclavian artery. And from the third part, you get the dorsal scapular artery. So, this is the dorsal scapular artery which arises from the third part of the subclavian artery.